Hey, I'm Kemi. I'm here with The Hook, and today we're at the Netflix premiere of their brand new series, The Sandman. Who would be your dream role or character to play? It could be something that's never been made, it could be a reboot, something that has been made.
You know, I think that I've dipped my toe in the world of action, and I think that would be really, really... I remember watching 300 when it came out and seeing like them doing all the 300 training as a group. And I think that's so fun to have something that has a life both in front of the camera and behind the camera. So
that would be great.
Yeah, it'd be really cool.
Obviously, this is about the land of dreams. So if there was a dream comic book character you'd like to bring to life, bar the Sandman, of course, who would that be?
Well, this is an awkward one because of the timing, but I've been a huge Batgirl fan for my entire life. And so it probably wouldn't be right for a white man to write Batgirl at this point, but she's the one that got away for me. I have loved every incarnation of that character.
I want to be female Russell Crowe in Gladiator, Asian Gladiator. But a story that rich, not just, ooh, Asians, they do kung fu. No, something that rich where that's unapologetic for being strong. At the same time, it's not just strong, because right now with the wokeness, with the progressiveness, a lot of the characters that come my way, they're just strong, that's it. As if anyone in life is just strong.
Probably like a combination of my dog, because I think he's got a really good life, and my dog, but he's an international footballer. There you go.
That's amazing.
Yeah, they're my two
dreams.
Yeah. So who would be your dream character to play?
Desire. Yes!
And even not in this show, in anything that could ever possibly be made, any book, any film, have you got a favourite character?
Anything evil?
Yeah.
Can I say that?
Oh, yeah.
Because I always get stuck with a nice girl. I'm so nice, but I wouldn't mind being mean as well.
Yeah.
I got some tricks up my sleeve.
Look at the producers still working on something else.
Call me.
So this is super geeky, but it's actually a play, my favorite play, Hedda Gabler, which is a Norwegian play by Henrik Ibsen. And actually she's a very conflicted, slightly dark character too, like my character in this. So I don't know, maybe there's something twisted in me that I'm trying to explore.
For people who aren't familiar with the comic, can you tell us about your character in the story?
Yes, I play Death. She is one of the Endless, part of a very dysfunctional family. We're essentially concepts that have been given sort of like humanistic qualities, and the way you see us is in sort of, you know, human shells.
So I play the character of Lyda Hall. She is a recently widowed young lady, and she is best friends with Rose.
Okay.
In a nutshell.
Okay, well, if they're absolutely not familiar with the comics, then the whole thing is about this guy called Hob Gadling. The entire series is based around me. And when I'm not on screen, they're talking about me and wishing I was there. I am a guy who has the audacity in the year 1389 to sit in a pub with his mates and say that dying is just what everyone does. And if you want to be really cool, you just say, I'm not going to die. And if you want to, you know, actually be individual and like original hipster, then you say you're not going to die. And Dream and Death overhear him, and they have a little bet with each other and say, okay, let's see what happens. And so the deal is, he can live as long as he wants, but every 100 years he has to check in with Dream and see whether he wants to carry on living.
So I come into it in episode 7. I'm in 3 episodes of mostly the serial convention. So anyone who's read about that will know what I mean. And what's great about my character is it's actually an amalgamation of a couple of characters from the comic that then became something that hopefully viewers will enjoy and respond to. Different gender, different. I'm really excited to hear what you all think.
My character is called Kate Fletcher. And it is a bit of a change from the actual visuals of the novel. And my story is in the one called 24/7, which is well known as the darkest and scariest of the series in comics, actually. It's traditionally like the most freak out episode, and you'll see why when you watch it, and you have to watch it. So that's my character, and it's basically we go through extremes, a lot of extremes, as precipitated by David Chulis's character, Dr. D, when he uses the ruby.
How has it been finally bringing this to life after decades?
It's, It was unbelievable. And it was the kind of thing that you don't really expect ever quite to happen like this. I'd spent so many years stopping terrible film versions of Sandman from happening, and that suddenly the fact that we've actually managed to make a great version of Sandman, and it's everything that we dreamed, and it's 10 episodes, and it tastes and it smells just like Sandman. I didn't think it was going to be possible, but I really feel we've done it.
Now, we've heard, obviously, there's been a lot of kind of like inclusive talent. How important was that representation and diversity for you?
It was important, but it was important from the word go back when I was doing Sandman. It's baked into the fabric of Sandman, which is one of the reasons I have very little patience for anybody grumbling about it now. It's like, guys, you could have grumbled in 1988. That was when you needed to start grumbling. But one of the things that we really did while we were casting Sandman was we just look at each part, and in a new unit of time, we'd say, okay, does this person need to be white? Does this person need to be male? Does this person need to be, what do they need to be? And a lot of the time, if the answers were no, it simply doubled the number of people that we could bring in on auditions. And that for me was the biggest thing. It wasn't a matter of finding any particular people, it was a matter of finding the right person. So someone like Viv Achampong for Lucien, once we'd heard her audition, there was nobody else. Kirby Howell-Baptiste, once she'd done Death, we were actually incredibly relieved, because at that point we'd seen about 600 auditions and none of them landed for us, and then she did.